In this video, we will recap the advantages and disadvantages of dynamic CMOS, as well as observe how logical effort can be calculated for dynamic gates. So, dynamic CMOS, when compared with static CMOS, has a bunch of advantages and a couple of disadvantages. The advantages of dynamic CMOS are that it preserves all the advantages of static CMOS. And so, when we looked at a dynamic gate, we noticed that V output high is equal to VDD and V output low is equal to 0 volt. So it preserves the ratioless logic of static CMOS. So the output value is always going to be rail to rail. It's going to have good noise margins, although, you know, so much good that that does us. And it's going to have zero steady state current because there's always an open circuit somewhere in the network. But dynamic CMOS also has advantages over static CMOS. It doesn't only preserve the advantages of static CMOS, otherwise we would just use static CMOS. The advantages of dynamic CMOS all have to do with delay. Dynamic CMOS is simply faster. On the other hand, dynamic CMOS has disadvantages relative to static CMOS. The thing about static CMOS is that the output node is always connected either to supply or to ground. Even when we have a slope for the input and a slope for the output, the problem is we have connections to both supply and ground. But when the input has become steady state, and when the output has become steady state, we have a low impedance path to either supply or ground. This makes it extremely robust, and it makes it resistant to a lot of effects that are detrimental in dynamic CMOS. So in dynamic CMOS, the output node could potentially be high impedance. This is seen, for example, when we use an N dynamic CMOS gate. This is seen when we are trying to evaluate a 1. When we are trying to evaluate a 1, the output node is open circuited from all directions. It's a high impedance node, it's a floating node. And therefore, if there is leakage, if there is charge sharing, or if there is even an attempt to cascade without taking into consideration the effects of cascading, we will have irretrievable loss of charge in the one phase of the clock, which leads to a degradation in the value of the logic one that we observe. All these effects, the effects from cascading, from charge sharing, and from leakage, are effects that also happen in static CMOS. They happen exactly the same way. If you go back and look at how these happen in dynamic CMOS and try to see if they also happen in static CMOS, they absolutely do. But the thing is, we don't care in static CMOS because there's always a path to supply or ground. There's no phase, there's no situation where we have high impedance nodes at the output, and therefore we don't actually care about these the impact of these phenomena. Now, to quantify the how much better dynamic gates are relative to static gates in terms of delay, let's calculate the logical effort of dynamic gates. And again, logical effort G was a unitless ratio that represented how much easier it is for a gate to drive itself relative to the unit inverter. So again, it's really important to notice that we are always measuring everything relative to the unit inverter, which is always a static CMOS inverter whose NMOS has an aspect ratio of 1 and whose PMOS has an aspect ratio of 2. So let's, for example, try to find the logical effort of a 2-input NAND gate in dynamic CMOS. So we have a PMOS transistor and an NMOS transistor, and we have 2 inputs A and B, right? So we size the NMOS transistor so that we have resistance equal to that of the unit inverter, and so we have 3, 3, and 3. And in fact, recall from module 4 that this doesn't mean that this is the final or actual sizing of the gate. This is just sizing that helps us find logical effort as a ratio of capacitances. And so logic effort for input A is going to be 3 divided by 3, where this 3 comes from this transistor and this 3 comes from the input of the unit inverter. And so logical effort is going to be 1. In fact, the two input NAND gate, if we use it in dynamic, in domino logic or in NP logic, then we actually do not need the NMOS tail transistor, right? After the first stage, we don't actually need the NMOS tail transistor. And so we could actually have sized it this way and gotten a GA of 2 over 3. In fact, if we look at a dynamic inverter that is used in a chain, where again, we don't need the tail transistors, the NMOS transistor could be sized at 1 for a G for this inverter of 1 over 3. Now we are noticing something really weird. We have a gate that is not an inverter whose logical effort is 1. In fact, we see logical efforts that are less than 1, which is something that we said in module 4 should be an impossibility. And it is true that it is an impossibility, but it is an impossibility in static CMOS. In dynamic CMOS, we can and we often actually do see logical efforts less than 1, which simply indicates that some dynamic gates, like the two-input NAND or the inverter, are faster than the static CMOS inverter. And that's just exactly what we concluded by virtue of considering the loading capacitance of dynamic CMOS. In fact, it's really interesting to look at NAND gates and NOR gates. Like, for example, we looked at the two-input NAND gate in dynamic CMOS. Let's look at the three-input NAND gate. Let's look at a three-input dynamic NAND gate. So this is going to be 3, 3, 3, and G is going to be equal to 1. So G for the two-input NAND, we concluded, was 2 over 3. And G for the 3-input NAND was 3 over 3. And so G for the N-input NAND is N over 3. So for an N-input NAND gate in dynamic CMOS, the logical effort is N over 3. Let's look at an N-input NAND gate in static CMOS. So we have 3 pull-down transistors and we have 3 pull-up transistors, right? And when we size these transistors, each of these is going to be 3, and each of these is going to be 2. And so we have a G of 2 plus 3 over 3, which is 5 over 3. And by induction for an N-input NAND gate, it's going to be 2 plus N over 3. And so it's obvious that for the dynamic NAND gate, the logical effort is less, and it's less by 2 over 3, which is caused by the loading of the PMOS transistor in the pull-up network in the static CMOS NAND gate. So a dynamic NAND gate is going to be better than a static NAND gate, but it's only going to be significantly better if the number of inputs is small. If the number of inputs is large, then this two becomes negligible. So let's look at how the situation looks for an N-input NOR gate. So imagine that you have a dynamic NOR gate and it has any number of inputs. I really don't care how many inputs it has. Each of the NMOS transistors is going to be sized at 1. And so G for this N-input NOR gate is going to be 1 over 3. This is incredible, actually, right? We have a gate, regardless of how many inputs it has, its logical effort is going to be constant. This is not the situation in the corresponding static gate. So if we have a 3-input static NOR gate, then each of the NMOS transistors is sized at 1, but each of the N of the PMOS transistors is sized at 2N, right? And so G for the N-input NOR gate in static CMOS is going to be 2N plus 1 over 3. So in fact, if you compare the NOR gates, right, the dynamic NOR gate is significantly better, not only better than the static NOR gate, but better than even the dynamic NAND gate. And so we can actually make a conclusion from this. We can extend this conclusion to the fact that dynamic gates are much better. They perform much better in terms of delay in circuits in which there are short pull-down chains. So in static CMOS, short pull-down chains means long pull-up chains, because the two are complementary, right? Which is horrible, because when you have long pull-up chains, as is the case here, you have a large loading from the PMOS transistor. So if you compare the NAND gate and the NOR gate in static CMOS, the NAND gate actually has better logical effort than the NOR gate, because you have to have a long chain. And so the option here is between having the long chain in the pull-up network or in the pull-down network. And of course, it's better to have it in the pull-down network because of the mobility of electrons. But in dynamic gates, you can actually not have the long chain if you push the long chain in the pull-up network, because there is no pull-up network. And so it's better to have circuits in which there are short chains in the pull-down network, and forget about the pull-up network because it doesn't exist. Now, this discussion shows the dynamic CMOS in a very positive light. Delays is excellent, but there are a couple of caveats here. First of all, don't forget the signal integrity issues that affect dynamic CMOS. And secondly, this discussion doesn't really take into consideration precharge. So precharge, the precharge delay, precharge phase of the clock is not taken into consideration while discussing dynamic CMOS. And so how to take it into consideration is a question. Maybe we should double it, in which case dynamic gates are still better, but it takes more inputs to make it better. And so sizing the PMOS transistor for pull-up and the precharge delay are important questions that have to be addressed. So in short, what is the verdict on dynamic logic? At first, it seemed to be the perfect logic family, but then we spent most of the module talking about its problems, which suggests maybe it's not so good after all. The answer is the majority of circuits we will make have to be static CMOS, because there's nothing that compares to static CMOS in terms of robustness and reliability and the fact that it produces the same output in every cycle. But dynamic CMOS is much faster. And so in certain chains, dynamic CMOS has to be used. Dynamic CMOS is particularly useful in arithmetic circuits, especially in fast adders. And it's also very useful in memories, not only in dynamic memories, but also as a reading mechanism in the majority of memory types, including static memories.